So welcome. As always, let's thank Localytics for the wonderful space. Any announcements, so just go drink like a bunch of their beer. It's good. All right, so my name's Joe. I helped co-organize a group with Gideon. I'm just curious, who is this anyone's first time coming? Oh, wow, okay, cool. All right, so Ryan's gonna talk to us a little bit about detecting interesting parts of images using ConvNets. Just disclaimer, there may be some content in the presentation. You know, there's maybe some nudity in the presentation, right? So just like, if you weren't aware of that before coming, fair warning. Okay? All right, cool. Without further ado.
Hey. So, my name is Ryan. I'm a data scientist at Clarifai. And today I'm going to talk about what do convolutional neural networks look at.
Right, I don't think the mic's working. So. Hello?
It is.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just carry it.
So, disclaimer, there may be a little bit of nudity in this talk. It'll be at the level of the entire Luna footprint. So nothing more explicit than that. In case nobody has seen Clarifai before, at the start of the talk, what I'd like to do is show a quick demo of the technology we build, as well as the technology that I'll talk about today. Oh, gotta go.
Sorry.
So here we have a photograph of a lake, and the way that we determined this was a lake was using a neural net. So with 99% confidence, we think this is a lake, wood, water, fall, no person, colors. We think this is winter, snow, wood, dog, a wolf, a mammal. The computer thinks this is a city, glass, a skyscraper. And you can do things too. Like here we have a 3-minute video. We're gonna pass this through a neural net. In less than 3 minutes, it's going to understand each frame in the video, then do a little bit of machine learning after that, and let it kind of chop up the video into different parts. So if I want the parts of the video that have snow, I can use the service to tell me, here's where the snow is in this video. And over here, there's less snow. More so. Okay, great. So one of the other things that happens in this demo, we go back to the dog. It also says the dog is SFW. So that's our short notation for safe for work. And the way that we do it is using a ConvNet. And I'm gonna talk about that a little bit more today. So back to the deck. So just for a second, I want people to think about, if you had to build a classifier to take in an image and determine if it has nudity or no nudity, and it's like 20 years ago, so the internet just came out, immediately it becomes super popular and people start using it to share porn. And you have a problem, which is that you want to filter it for certain domains, certain customers. You just don't want to see nudity on your site. So 20 years ago, I think a real seminal paper in the field is this one. It's called Finding Naked People. And the way that they do this paper is really cool. They do this kind of the way I think a lot of people would try to come up with a solution for this problem without thinking about, you know, neural nets and representation learning. So they have this approach which you look at color and texture properties to get a mask of skin regions. The skin mask is shown to be effective for a wide range of shades and color of skin. And then you send them into a grouper, which attempts to group a human figure using constraints on human structure. So because we're humans, there's a few different ways that your arm can go. There's a few different ways that your legs can go. There's usually legs, below arms, in the middle. And if you have a bunch of skin, you can then make a decision like, here I have a segment, this is an arm. Maybe I can assemble that arm into like, you know, a limb. Like, so there's like a part of an arm, another part of an arm, this entire arm. Maybe I have two legs that are next to each other. There's a face. This is all looking at skin. So now I have a face, and I have two arms. I have like the spine, and then I have two legs, and there's this guy. He's like this. And so this is probably a picture of some naked person based on these constraints, what we think they look like. So we should flag this, and we should say, okay, filter that image. So let's take a look at what it does. You can see over here on this photo on the right, it's got this guy here, and he's kind of all skin up and here and there. You find this other thing, it looks like nudity. It correctly identifies the guy on the right as nudity. That's what the algorithm fired on, that's what it thought was relevant. Same thing with over here, you can kind of see this is a lot of skin, the person is doing just what we thought they would do, and then we should remove that image. Some of them, it's kind of harder to understand why it fired on this photograph. Maybe it thought there was a person cross-legged here, I don't know, but it fired on her too. So these are all the correct, you know, examples of when the algorithm worked. And when the algorithm doesn't work, it finds stuff like this. So here's a loaf of bread. The loaf of bread has, like, you know, a flesh-toned bread and a flesh-toned cookie cutting board, and then a spine over here. So it thinks that's two legs, maybe, and somebody's on their back, and it's going to flag this as a potential nudity photograph. Other photos here, same kind of thing. You get skin-toned objects, it assembles them, and it thinks, okay, the computer thinks this is nudity because of the way its algorithm is putting together the rules, and therefore, these are, you know, false positive examples. And what they did here is actually, I think, really cool, because they wrote this computer program to solve the problem that we're interested in solving. And then they built this little visualization platform to see, okay, now that I know what the algorithm says about the image, I can go back and I can ask the algorithm, why did you say this about this particular image? And then I can debug it, I can say, look, my grouping rules are not particularly good. I can change the rules I use to assemble the skin detector into a human figure. So I think this is a really good work that they're doing here, and I think that I really like these figures that they made. And this was 1996 that they published this. A lot of other people have worked on this problem too in academia. Another approach would be SIFT. You kind of change your feature engineering to say, okay, instead of using a SIFT feature descriptor, you can use something called U-SIFT, which is going to be more sensitive to skin. So a lot of skin detection is kind of done because we always think about skin when we think about this problem. Here's another paper. This paper is kind of interesting. They wanted to get using text and images to find if the entire website is just a porn site. So you look at, you know, the text they did totally separately. They used something called a CNN, which they call a cellular neural network, and they use that for text. But then they have this other skin detection approach, where what they do is they use this blocks of regions that are mostly skin, and then they have a contour expansion method. This could be something like Chan Vese, geodesic active contour. Some kind of contour segmentation method is going to expand within these blocks of skin. And if it's big enough, they're going to say, okay, this looks like nudity. I should flag this image as nudity. And this paper, I think, is really good. This paper, I think this is a really interesting demonstration of how hard the feature engineering gets. What these guys did is similar. They had a different way of finding the skin, and then they have these blobs of skin. So you have this photograph here, and then you have this blob over here. And then what they did was they made an ROC curve. They compared, on top of the features they extracted, they compared a multi-layered perceptron, a GLM, an SVM classifier, and they get this ROC curve to show your true positive rate and your false positive rate. And on top of the features they find that the multi-layered perceptron was the best. But I think they have this like one paragraph, which I really like to read. For each blob in the image, we have computed area, centroid, the length of the major axis of an ellipse with the same second order moments as the blob, the minor axis length, eccentricity and orientation of the same ellipse, the area of a convex hull fitted to the blob, the diameter of a circle with the same area as the blob, the solidity, which is the proportion of the convex hull area accounted for by the blob, the extent, which is the proportion of the area of a rectangular bounding box accounted for by the blob, the number of colors in the image, and the area of any faces in the image. So kind of by hand, you think about what these features should be. You come up with this big list of features after your skin detector. And then on top of those features, you sort of run these different classifiers. And then you have a way of flagging nudity in photos. And this is a lot to think about just for this problem. So if you had to go back and redo this to figure out like a dog classifier, you might have to figure a different type of decision there, which would be very time consuming. But if you keep going in this direction, right? So that was, you know, 20 years of research kind of summarized with a few papers that I had picked out. And then eventually, if you keep pushing in this direction, you're going to get somebody, maybe it's maybe Jonah Hill here, who's going to like really, really get into feature engineering and solve this problem like the best you could ever expect anybody to do. And that would be the way that computer vision progresses if we stay on that path. But it's not really what happened. It's not the product that we have. So what I'm going to talk about a little bit is what we call a convolutional neural net, or a CNN. A CNN, that last paper I talked about, they had a lot of very complicated rules that the researchers came up with to learn a lot of features, and then at the end they had a classifier to determine SVM, KNN, something like that, to flag the image yes or no. Every type of convolutional net that you see is going to have a convolutional layer and a pooling layer. So the thing that happens in a convolutional net is you take an input image, you slide it through a bunch of different convolutional filters. So for example, if I had a vertical line filter, I could slide vertical line filter around the image. And then I would get back a map of where all the vertical lines are. And maybe I have also a horizontal line filter. So I slide a horizontal line around the image until I find all the horizontal lines. Maybe I have other kinds of edge detectors in there. Then I have another operation called pooling. Pooling we're going to talk about a bit more in a second, but pooling will take something like a 4x4 grid of pixels, pick the largest activation in those 4x4 grids, throw the rest of them away, save that one, and go to the next layer. And the reason we do pooling is because it takes this gigantic amount of data, because after you run those filters, you get this huge tensor, and then you compress it to much less. And you also have a nice way to deal with invariance. So a line that's over here versus a line that's over here, after the pooling, it kind of gets mapped to the same thing. So deal with a little bit of noise. So if you go through the network all the way up to the end, you get to what's called the fully connected layer. This is just a usual multi-layer perceptron, and then you get your predictions at the end. The interesting thing about the neural net is that as you go through this network, the thing that you get here is going to be a very low-dimensional representation relative to the image size, and it's going to have a lot of semantic information about images in this representation. So if this is, say, 256 by 256 by 3, that's 200,000 floating point numbers to like represent all those different values. And then at the end, you might have something that's like a 1,024-dimensional vector, with the property that vectors that are close to each other correspond to images that are perceptually similar. So just to give a little example of what that could look like, here I have a bunch of images. These are all safe for work. And in the safe for work data, there's this really cool little organization on it. So for example, the fireworks here are close to the fireworks. Like the flowers are close to the flowers. The guitars are close to the guitars. And the way I made this photograph, it's kind of an interesting artistic picture. I didn't do that by hand. I took that last layer of the neural net. Those are 1,024-dimensional vectors in the neural net I used. I mapped it down to two dimensions with a standard dimension reduction thing I called a T-SNE. And then I said, okay, images that are close together, I'm going to snap them onto a grid using a thing called the Hungarian algorithm, and I'm going to get this nice looking picture. So just kind of to demonstrate that the higher layers in the net have a lot of semantic information, this kind of picture, you know, nice way to show that. So what the other thing we did is we used a convolutional net to make a model, or to make a classifier to filter out nude. And it got this rock curve, which is really good, right? It's just looks just like this. It's hitting the corner. Maybe my test data was too easy, but this is a really good rock curve by, I think, any standard. So how do I do that? And I take my safe for work training data, I take my not safe for work training data, and then I take a ConvNet. In this talk, the ConvNet that I'm going to use is going to be a modified ZFNet. So it's 5 convolutional layers. It's going to have, at the end, 3 fully connected layers. There's also pooling between the layers. ReLU activations. I have a softmax output for safe. a softmax output, but not safe. The whole thing is about 70 million parameters. And the way that you do this is, once somebody has decided a good architecture for a neural net, you take your data and you train it, and then you test it. And the thing about this that I think I want to remark on is, this neural net architecture, if I wanted to swap this data out to be, say, like a dog versus a Ferrari, I wouldn't have to go back and re-engineer all my features again. I could take the same neural network architecture, and then just swap out the training data. So as a data scientist at Clarifai, I spend most of my time actually modifying training data sets rather than reconfiguring networks on existing training data sets. So I do this process, I make a data set, I pick a network, I train it, and then I test it, and then I get the following kind of thing. If I'm in academia, I can publish, like, if this works. Because if I do this kind of process, and it works really well in the test set, then I know I'm not overfitting because I worked on the test set. Maybe this is MNIST or CIFAR, so I have a standard test set that everybody agrees on. And if you configure a good neural net, then you'll get a good, you know, result on your test set, and then you publish, and that's the end of the game. So that's good. But if you work at an industry with a machine learning company, sometimes you have a different situation. So, like, one of the things that happens with these neural nets, because there aren't public academic data sets on what is nudity and what is not nudity, you kind of have to make up in your head, you know, what sites have a lot of porn, what sites do not. I'm going to go out and collect that porn, so we write crawlers, and then we have like people labeling it. And then we go, we get all that data, and it's based on the specifications of what I think should go into each bucket, or maybe someone else in my company thinks should go into each bucket. We just kind of, we build the data set to the best of our ability, and then we get a good result on our data set. And our network is probably good too. And then when we go out and we deploy it to our customers, we get all these emails back, and they'll say like, no, you didn't try this on like this chandelier penis, and you didn't try this on these weird cartoons, and like all this other stuff that you didn't really think about. You start getting emails from your customers because they're throwing data at you that you had not put into your brain when you were building the test set or the training set. So what I want to talk about now is, you know, if you have a network and it's working well, how can I kind of go into the network and look at it and sort of talk about what's going on? Why is the network making the decisions that it makes? So one experiment you can try, if you didn't know anything about your classifier, you could just take an image. So here I take an image over, like a picture of Lena. I'm going to crop out a little square of skin. I'm going to send that square to our API. And then if it turns out that it's nudity, the API is going to return back like a high score. I'm going to color it red. And if it turns out that it's not nudity, I'm going to color it blue. I'm going to look at these little windows and slide this around until I get this nice heat map showing me where the classifier is activating. And you see like anything that has like a square that's entirely skin, maybe entirely skin with this little arm crevasse, it's going to be nudity. And it gives you some idea of what the classifier cares about. And then the other way you can think about that experiment would be, let's say I was trying to black out a part of the image. I want to show the image on television. And then I'm going to figure out what things I should pixelate and blur out. I'm going to slide around these little black boxes. If I blur out the thing that the classifier cares about, I'm going to color this red, because this is the thing that made the image safe when I covered up this zone, and the rest of it is blue. But it's not totally right, because if you cover up this zone here, you still see this zone down here. So like covering this doesn't tell me anything about the classifier says. But these occlusion experiments are kind of interesting, because this is the first thing you might try if you knew nothing about the classifier you were using. If you were doing this with Mechanical Turk, you could get the same kind of thing happening. You could just send each little square or each little image to people and then average the results. But then, you know, and I did this. Actually, I did this with our API. And our API is closed source, so you can, like, you know, just knowing that our API does something, you can make these kind of pictures. And most of that code is actually just cutting the images out. It's actually not calling the neural net. But we know that it's a convolutional net, because that's what I said at the start of the talk. And what I want to do is I want to talk about how to go backwards in a convolutional net. I want to talk about, given a particular prediction and an image, I want to reverse it and figure out
why did the network fire on these particular parts of that image? And deconvolutional networks actually mean a couple of different things. So usually you say, okay, this is going to provide a way to map activations at high layers back down to the input. It's the same thing as in a ConvNet. So there's a feature map, which can like get max pooling done to it. You have to reverse max pooling, which is a little bit weird because you throw away all that information when you find the maximum. And then going backwards through a convolution, that's what you do when you do backpropagation through a convolution. So you have the transpose operation, and then you just backprop on that. And sometimes there's an upsampling if there was a stride in the original convolution. And for the purpose of this talk, it's just going to be to probe an existing network that we already trained. But that's not when they were invented. The actual invention of deconvnets happens in another paper that was before the famous one on this, where they were an unsupervised method, which was kind of a competitor with sparse coding. And they were proper deconvolutions. They weren't just like a backpropped convolution. They were a proper deconvolution. And I'm going to talk about those a little bit before I talk about the deconvolutional ones. So sparse coding is, there's a ton of papers on this. It's a gigantic part of applied math. So you have an image. You want to find a representation of it in some dictionary D. You want to find the fewest number of dictionary elements you can to represent the image. So you take a linear combination of dictionary elements. You solve an optimization problem. So maybe this is your fidelity term. This is an L1 penalty. You solve this optimization, and you want to find a representation of the image using the smallest number of dictionary elements. And the dictionary elements, you can do all kinds of stuff to come up with them. And also, you can do that by hand. Wavelets, curvelets, framelets, shapelets, shearlets. You can search forever, and you can find examples of dictionaries that people use as like a fundamental building block of images. So at the end of that, you'll have a sparse vector, and ideally you have an image which has been denoised because you only found the significant edges, or you find an image that could be deconvolved. You could find a lot of nice image processing techniques as a result of a good sparse coding algorithm. A deconvnet with only one layer is the same thing. Instead of a linear combination of its dictionary elements, it's usually written as a convolution with filters. And the goal is to learn the filters as well as the fewest number of coefficient convolutions to map against the basis. And then you end up with a representation of the image that was constructed from deconvolutions. And if you do that for one layer, you end up learning like very basic edges on the first layer. So you learn edge detectors, and then these other kind of horizontal edge detectors, dot detector, like sort of square detectors. And these kinds of things that you learn in a deconvnet, when you learn those convolutions, as well as with that sparsity prior, it's very similar to something that a psychologist and neuroscientist named DeMar figured out years ago as the primitive, or he calls it primal sketch theory. It's like a primitive representation of what he believes mammals see when they look at an image at the very basic level. He came up with these by hand in like the 70s as what we think as the basis of perception. And then the deconvnet will learn that on the first layer. But then the deconvnet, what it does beyond sparse coding is it actually has a few layers. So it will take the first layer, the second layer, and the third layer. And what it'll do is it'll learn more higher level, more complicated, more interesting filters the higher up you go in the net. And then the goal at each layer is to reconstruct the output of the previous layer. So the deconvnet, it's not super popular. It works pretty well, but it doesn't do anything fantastic. But it's kind of like a competitor with sparse coding as unsupervised image processing work. So if you actually look at the paper, this is the figure you'll see. As you go through the neural net, you'll go below the pooled maps, you'll do a convolution, you'll do a ReLU, you'll do max pool, and in the regular neural net, you'll just keep going. But then you have to solve this problem in the deconvnet of going backwards. So these switches is what I'll talk about for a second here. Like we talked about, a max pooling finds the maximum of four different squares and just propagates that to the next layer. I can't reverse that, right? Because it's the maximum, it's not a reversible operation. So here's my feature map on one layer. I'm going to look at the max in the yellow squares, the max in the red squares, max in the blue or the max in the green. When I do max pooling, I end up with something like this that goes into the next layer. But if I'm interested in doing a reconstruction or a deconvnet, when I do this operation, I'm going to save the location that I used to do this pooling operation. So in this guy over here, it was the top left square had the biggest activation. So when I do the pooling, not only am I going to propagate that value, I'm also going to save on these switches the value of the fact that the top left square was the one that had the maximum. So in the event that I have to go backwards through that layer and move the activations back, I can then just go and say, look, if I have these switches and I have these values, I'll then put zeros in the rest of the place and then save the location and that value and put that backwards. So reversing max pooling, it's not totally possible, but to write that deconvnet paper, they had to figure this guy out, and this is what they did. It works just fine. And then the discovery was, once you have a trans neural net, let's only do that backwards operation, and let's see what happens on an existing image, or with an existing net, and an existing image, to see how we can pull apart a convolutional net. So when you run these operations on a trans net, you can look at the activations on the first layer, and you can look also at the second layer. So the first layer is always just going to be standard edge effects. Look at the second layer. You get slightly more interesting features. So this network that I'm showing you right now, this is just trained on ImageNet, plain old, regular, safe network. And you'll see things like the circle on the second layer. Or you'll see things like maybe multiple edges that's sort of like a curve detector. Once you get to the third layer, you've been assembling through max pooling those slightly more complicated features in the second layer into even more interesting features with a larger field of view in the third layer. So here you have things like an entire kid space. And you might have things like a bird's eye. Entire number. There's a car wheel down here. And then you see, like, as you go further up, here's the fourth layer. It's even, you know, higher resolution, larger field of view for each neuron. And you'll see there's something like a dog's face. Or like entire bird's head. And the way you get these kind of maps is you run the net on a ton of images. And once you find an image that very strongly activates a neuron that you're interested in, you're going to freeze the network there and you're going to say, okay, in that particular layer, set everything equal to zero except for this one neuron, which is already pretty active. Set him equal to one. And then go do all those operations backwards, fill in, you know, using the switches, fill in the missing data, do the backwards convolution that you see in backprop, and then at the end you get back these kind of these maps that show you, okay, look, this image would look more like a dog if there was more brown in the nose or black in the eye. And the fifth layer for the network that we're talking about, the fifth layer is the top of the net. You see, look, this is like, it's very sensitive to human faces, so got this guy, if his nose was more red, if his cheeks were more red, if his lips were more red, it'd be more like a face. And then over here you have a monkey. So it's learning a lot of stuff. And these maps were not done by hand. I didn't have to go and say, this is what a monkey looks like, this is what a dog looks like, this is what a person looks like. I let the computer figure this out. All I have to do is give it labeled data. So now let's look at the network that I was talking about earlier on. So here we have the first layer in the network that filters nudity. It's the same as usual, it's just edges. You get to the second layer and you start to see, okay, here you have a lot of just, you know, there's curves and there's these pink dots everywhere. So, like, this kind of stuff is really important to the second layer. These are going to propagate further through the net. On the third layer, you start to really see stuff that you think about would be relevant to a network to filter inappropriate images. So here you can see, like, only three layers in, you've got like an entire nipple. You have
like another one, this one is smaller but still there. And then there's some other parts of the image. Like up here is kind of interesting. Looks like up here there's like this, like a knee, and then maybe there's like something back here. It could be a bathing suit. This spiral, I have no idea. And it's going, it's finding slightly more interesting features. Here we have the fourth layer. The fourth layer is getting a little bit harder to zoom in on this. But in the fourth layer, you might see things like, okay, you'll see this one again. So you see this is like very high resolution map that you found over here. It finds like the somebody's back. It's getting like pretty good detail here. The fifth layer has done a lot better. Here's a few that I thought were really interesting in the fifth layer. So these are some images. So let's say I take like this one, like up here. Like these are very high resolution maps that without telling the computer anything except for these images, yes, these images, no, and here's a neural network architecture, like figure out what you should activate on in order to like filter those images. So the thing that's real interesting here is that these kind of things, like they're a lot more detailed than anybody would come up with by hand, unless you're really artistic or creative or dedicated to this particular problem, which has like five or six really important things that you're going to try to remove from your database. Okay, so what if I show a safe image and then I try to push it in the direction of being not safe? And, you know, I'm kind of curious now. I want to look at an image that I know is safe, and I want to ask the computer, what makes this not safe? How would you change this to make it not safe? I do the same procedure, and I look at this photo. This is Barbara. It's not Lena. This is kind of like a nicer version of Lena. It's open source. It's not from Playboy. So Barbara, it looks at this and it says, oh, you could make this image more like nudity if you made her lips really, really red. And to me, that actually sounds kind of reasonable, because if I go through my training data and I looked at everybody's lips, I would probably find there was a lot of like lipstick going on, much more than in the other training data, which was people as well as things like cars and other stuff that was just not really tuned in to just shiny, try to catch your eye. Was this image? Oh, it's a cake. This was something that was posted on Pinterest. It was on Pinterest that got banned by Pinterest's filter. And if you run through our net and you go backwards, you see like the computer is finding all these kinds of things in it, which like it thinks it's a safe image, but if it wasn't safe, this is what it would care about. This is a photo of Ursula undressed. This is from a James Bond movie. Again, it's looking for red lips. It's also serious about navels, so belly buttons. Like, if you have a lot of photographs of naked people, you're also going to have a lot of photographs of belly buttons. And it zooms in on that even before it zooms in on, like, the bikini, because she's got, like, everything is covered up. So it really fires on this kind of thing. And then this photograph, this is, like, a lamp and on the ceiling. And it's actually, yeah, it's picking out the stuff that I think, you know, if it was trying to make this look like nudity, you'd want to make these, like, beautiful. So that's what the network cares about. The network is trained for about a week. I really ran this thing for a long time. And then as it was training, you can kind of run this experiment before it's finished converging. So at the start, if I look at this photo is another photo of Lena from the other part of that photo shoot. And initially, it's really noisy. It doesn't do a great job of like finding high resolution features. And a few epochs later, it gets a little better, but it didn't find the stuff I cared about. And a few more epochs, it starts to get more decisive. There's less of the initial random noise that you give an untrained net. It's getting better at finding the features it cares about. It's got it wrong this time. It's like really finding the face, but it's then eventually getting to here. So the navel, the one on the right, but not the one on the left. So the network, you give it data, you train it, you penalize it when it's wrong, and eventually it kind of learns to figure out, you know, going from this to this to this to this to this, it learns the features that matter. So just to recap, if you try to build a classifier like this in 2016, the feature maps that we have, they're like this on the left over here. Whereas back 20 years ago, we only had this level of
of resolution. And the way we got there was by inventing neural nets, not by coming up with really good hand-drawn future maps. So that's what we do, and that's the way that the algorithm kind of thinks about things. Now I want to talk about what we definitely can't figure out. So context. This is beyond the scope of computer vision right now. So if you look at this picture, there's a ton of stuff going on. There's a baby, there's George Bush, he's supposed to kiss the baby, he doesn't. That's funny because he's a politician. I think it's funny. I'm really tuned into this because I'm a person. Like, a ton of stuff is going on. But the computer, like our API, just says people, adult, facial expression, elderly. It's like not really smart about anything. It finds objects, because even with those high resolution maps that we learned, we don't really understand the way objects interact with each other. We don't understand culture. We don't understand a ton of other stuff that really matters to make images interesting. So here we have a Buddha who's pinching a plane. The plane is like, you know, in the statue's hand. It's kind of neat, but the computer thinks nothing of that. This guy is high-fiving a whale. That's really cool. But it just thinks underwater swimming fish. It's nothing particularly interesting. Yeah, fish. And then there's this, right? So this, who knows what this picture is? This was in The Guardian. Maybe not everybody has seen this.
Yeah, it's a kid.
This is the refugee. I'm not going to show this one because it's like not boobies. It's like actually really upsetting. But this is a picture that is about somebody drowned during from the Syrian refugees. We're trying to make it over. And if you actually show this picture to a lot of people, this is really upsetting. And it's really upsetting because of all the context around it. And if you're trying to keep your site clean and safe and something you want in your school, you just don't want this on somebody's desktop. But if you run this through our API, it doesn't understand. It doesn't understand what's going on. It's going to label this as beach in person and stuff like that. So all the additional context that's necessary for filtering out nudity is still like way beyond the scope of what we can do with the feature extraction we've been talking about, the representations that the computer learns. And then the other thing, I'm going to show a quick demo here about customizing stuff. When we build this network, it works really well, but if you have, say, a dating website and everybody is the same ethnicity, we were working with some of these companies and the performance just wasn't there. So we want to customize our neural nets. So really quick, let me show you the way we do that. So here I take, for example, this this is an app, and I want to train a classifier. Let's say I want to train a classifier for like amazing red galactic things. I could create a classifier. So I'm just going to fine tune a neural net. I'm going to train it. It is training. Give it a second. Now it's trained. Back, search over my data, and then I say, look, here's all the things that looked like the classifier I taught. Right now, we only do this on our general model. We're pretty good at fine-tuning classifiers to figure out new objects. What we're moving towards in the future is then to take the base of that neural net before you have those, like, you know, classifiers on those vectors we talked about at the start, and then fine-tuning the not-safe-for-work model to work in your context, because everybody has a slightly different idea of what they want to filter. Some people only want to filter XXX. Some people only want to filter PG-13. It just depends on what you care about. So we're building out custom training for not safe for work in the near future to solve this kind of problem. And it's kind of cool to be able to make classifiers with just a small amount of clicks and a small amount of data. So moving towards that. So that's kind of the summary. We have, you know, hiring data and research. Lots of data at our company. There's a few of us. And you can publish if you collaborate with us as a university student. So send emails. What's my time like? It's 7:22. Okay, cool.
The pizza's here. So maybe like, while we're asking questions, if anyone's like really hungry and they're gonna like clap, so they want some pizza, you can get some pizza, or we can yell, just be cool, just try to be a little quieter.
Well, so if you get cups and stuff,
experiment with Google caption generating for the context?
Yeah, I think that's the right way to go. So the thing with context, generating captions, I think is the right issue, or the right way to go about it. So one of the requests I got for the not safe for work model was really hard to do, and people wanted to know what object is inside of like what orifice, and like as soon as that happens, there's no pixels on like the object of interest, so you don't really know. Well, because it's inside of something.
Oh, right.
So the picture doesn't have it. So you have to understand the other stuff around it to get the rest of the context. So even like even beyond like all of that really high level hand-wavy stuff about culture, just like the relationship between objects and the image should be able to really get as far, at least in some problems related to what we have now. Because otherwise, otherwise I'm not sure how to do it. So that kind of model where they use the RNNs to generate sequences, I think is the right way to go. I haven't done a lot of work on that, but I definitely like that approach. If you had a ton of time and like a really permissive advisor in grad school, that would be kind of a cool problem to try and solve, especially with videos, because like you have the previous frame and the next frame and you can see like before there's an occlusion, what was happening. I think there's a lot of ways to go in that direction.
So you mentioned the problem almost like the Bayesian networks, kind of like having the errors, having to go back. How do you deal with that same conditions here? When you're getting some images that somehow were misclassified or whatever, and how you come back to the model to train it better? Is it learning from errors in any kind of way and things like that as part of the feedback loop?
Right. So in the feedback loop, you're talking about things like
the local bread that you had at one time.
Like this guy, right? Like I do this by hand, and I see there's a belly button. And the belly button isn't exactly the kind of thing I wanted to filter by. Because I could correctly get that RO curve. I could correctly get that ROC curve by finding all the belly buttons if my training data was bad. So the feedback loop, I don't know how to do this without having like me in the loop, but the feedback loop would be, okay, look, I do this process, I find a feature that the network is activating on, the feature isn't the kind of thing that I want, so I have to go re-engineer my training data to then say, okay, I'm gonna have a ton of pictures where people have their belly buttons out, but there's not nudity. And then it would train the network again, and then hopefully do better and not accidentally flag something like this as nudity. Is that more or less the question?
So let me summarize that. So you have to kind of get the suspicious pictures or whatever misclassified, basically. And you say, okay, based on that, you decide what new training set you're going to, or part of the test set or training set that you're going to provide back. So the filter somehow moves a little bit towards accepting those.
That's right. You actually don't need to even have it be misclassified. I can just kind of say, here's whatever image. Like, I can take this image. And then I can say, how do I modify this image to make it not safe? Because I could just go into the network and change the weights at the end however I want. So I don't need to find an image that looks that way. I could just pick a target that I wanted it to be misclassified as, and then go backwards from that. And then if I do this and I say, look, to make this thing more not safe, instead of firing on this guy, if it was firing like down here on something totally unrelated, I would be a little bit suspicious. But the idea is like with the bread, you look at that bread and you say, okay, images that are kind of like a tube of flesh-colored food and then a cutting board is going to confuse it, then you can re-engineer your rules. And with this, I could, if I could go back on that image, I can't get the original image. But if I could go back on that and then find it was looking at something, making it not safe because of something about the bread, I would just put a bunch more bread in my safe over training set, is the way I would do it.
Just as a follow-up question, sorry for asking another question after that. But you basically take this picture, and you're creating multiple, almost variants out of the same picture, or you're taking new inputs into the system versus recreating synthetic data.
That's something else, but that's not what I do.
Okay.
There is another way to like do this and generate other examples and have the networks fight. But the way that this
happens for me is, like, we'll take this network, we'll send it out to customers, they'll come back to us with all these crazy pictures, and then I'll sometimes say, okay, I actually do care about that mistake they told me about, and then I will do some experiment like this and say, oh, actually, on cartoons, it finds this thing, or something like that. This kind of analysis is really just so I can rebalance the training data. And if that never gets me anywhere, maybe I'll have to think about a different neural network architecture, but I usually don't. That's often someone else's job.
Are people using this layer visualization to train neural nets, like custom nets, right now? Or if not, you know, how far ahead in the future do you think before your customers start wanting to train their own nets?
Well, people don't really know about this, so they don't want it. So I do have aspirations to put this up behind an endpoint, so you can go to our site and then give it an image and then give it a network, and then we'll say, aha, this is your image and why our network thought it was this way. But in terms of like having that loop happen through an API, it's not there right now. People do ask, why did your network say this about my image? And then via emails, like sometimes they get a picture like this, but via just like the API, we don't have that.
Yeah. Could reduce emails if you...
Right. Yeah. But actually, it would probably increase emails, is what I think.
So do you train a deconvnet along with the classifier as a matter of course? How expensive is that?
Well, actually, the deconvnet, once you train the classifier, you can then do this backwards operation on whatever trained classifier you have. So there was two types of deconvnets. I think I might have not been super clear. But there was one type of deconvnet, just given the image, no labels, learn the whole thing. And that we don't do at all. The other thing is, given a neural net, f-prop an image up to some certain layer, save all those switches, and then back-prop down, using those switches to figure out how to undo the pooling. And you don't actually have to train a separate network for that. You use an existing net and all the existing filters that were learned in the regular training process. So given whatever net you have, you can then do this procedure on it.
So what's the neural net circuitry for the switches? What's feeding into a switch in order for it to decide where the maximum was? So why do you need the switches at all? Why not just have the same value in a given? Oh, because they overlap. You can't.
Yeah. So if I'm going like, oops, I'm gonna go back. So if I go all the way to, I click this like 60 times. So the reason you need those switches is, I think if I understand this, like this is smaller than this. So to undo the pooling, I have to take this and explode it back up to the dimensions that I can then do the conv on.
But you could use a uniform distribution when you expand out instead of just picking one cell. But I guess you can't do that because the convolution windows overlap.
Yeah, the windows overlap. Also, the switches also save the information about the image. Because if the layer that I froze at the end was the one in the neuron I cared about and zero everywhere else, there's a ton of images that can produce that. So as I'm going backwards, if I don't have any image about the thing I was f-propping, I have to somehow push that in as I'm going back. And the switches are the only place it actually happens, is which of those activations was the biggest.
Oh, so the switches aren't learned. They're observed during the form.
Yeah, that's the record, yeah. Observed. I think there was one over here.
How do you keep track of all your training sets? Like, you have so many, and you need the changes. If you have a regression, how do you know?
That's my job. I do that using, we have them in Hadoop, and there's a file, it's a YAML file, it says where they are, it's really big. So the way we keep track of them, In the tool I showed you, in our API, you get an application that has all of your images and all of the metadata that you added with those images, and then you can use our API to search either by your metadata or your annotations or by the predictions of the classifier. Now, in terms of like our internal infrastructure, we have like several hundred terabytes of data. It's all in HDFS and like these directory trees that I, you know, and that's how we keep track of it.
Do you have over time like all the different training sets that you trained with?
We do, and it's in like a little documents, comments and stuff.
Sort of related to his question, so I was kind of thinking about the same thing. Suppose you replace the max pooling operation with a bunch of sigmoids, and you actually backpropagated through all of the sigmoidal hidden units and sum them as if they were in a set of overcomplete basis functions, and basically, because none of the image components are going to match exactly to any of your filters. So I'm wondering if that would give you sort of an estimate of a higher more accurate slash higher resolution estimate of the original input.
I'm not sure. So the other thing, I didn't talk about the ReLUs or the TANT or the
sigmoids.
Yeah, so usually like this in between these there's ReLUs, mm-hmm. and the ReLUs going backwards is nothing fantastic. It's the numbers that are bigger, there's Y equals X, and then the stuff that's smaller is usually not even interesting. So the ReLUs, you just push those back the same way they went in, and then you just run that again, which works. The replacing max pool with sigmoid, I think there could be something there. I don't quite know how I would do it because these have like hard-coded numbers of inputs and outputs, and as I'm going backwards, like the sigmoids, I still have to somehow change this square to match the size of this square. So somehow I have to expand it. And since it's...
Yeah, I'm just talking about backpropagating basically weighted summations instead of picking the max.
I think something could happen there. There's a few other papers on doing these visualizations. I actually don't know the details of them. So there's two or three other papers. You can totally get rid of the switches. So there's a paper called the All Convolutional Net. And they just remove the pooling and stuff. And they only have convolutions going up and convolutions going back. And then you get rid of this weird unpooling problem. A totally different approach. Some people think that's a lot more clear. And that one might be more related to what you're describing, but I'm not sure.
And then some people are using ReLUs actually with a modified negative slope, a smaller negative slope, and maybe that would be applicable.
Yeah, that strided, the all convolutional net paper has a nice diagram, which is not in my slides, but they have a nice diagram where they talk about the different ways you can backprop through that aspect of it, and I don't know if there's a negative slope example. Sometimes it's like sets up to zero, sometimes there's different ways of doing that part of moving the activations back.
Just do one more if there's any other questions. That like never happens. One more.
So you mentioned that the main work goes into adjusting the training set rather than the neural net architecture. So what are the general principles for adjusting the training set in order to improve the performance?
So there's a few ways to answer that. I think the way I like to think of it is a general principle. If I had to adjust the training set to improve the performance, there's this whole paradigm of active learning. So if instead of having like a data scientist in the loop, if you just had Mechanical Turk, you train a thing, things are wrong, you have some type of budget and cost function that's going to tell you I can only relabel this many examples or I can only acquire this many examples, and then I'm going to find the ones that are closest to the boundary and send those out to humans, they're going to relabel stuff, and then the next iteration I should do better. So in terms of general rules, I think active learning is the paradigm. But in terms of my work, because I'm like more expensive than Mechanical Turk, so when I see this happen, it happens along the ways of how many emails I get. It tells me which things I want to prioritize. So if it's wrong for somebody I don't care about, then I often do nothing. If it is wrong, like I'll just look at these things and then I'll see if it's wrong about something that is important to me. So if it is.
And then find more examples.
And then find more examples that way, yeah. So, and then I'll just actually send queries for that to humans to get it, like, you know, 20,000 more examples that look like that, and then retrain.
Yeah.
But in terms of general rules, there's not really general rules to that, because I'm always just kind of thinking I should do more this way instead of that way. The real general rule is going to be called active learning, and then you can kind of not have a slide deck about how to do that. It's just
great.
Codebase.
Let's take any more questions offline, and thanks, speaker Dan.